This is a meeting of the Ferndale Public Schools Board of Education held on Monday, December 14th, 2015. The meeting is being recorded for broadcast on cable and on the district's YouTube channel. All meetings in the Ferndale schools are held in public in compliance with the Open Meetings Act. Printed documents discussed in tonight's meeting are available to the public on our website and on request, with the exception of any information protected by student or employee privacy rights. Board meeting information is posted on our website at ferndaleschools.org. If you don't have internet access and need that information, please contact the board offices at 248-586-8652 by Thursday of the week prior to the meeting, and district staff will do their best to assist you. So with that, may we have a roll call, please, Ms. Shepherd?
Butters, here. Dean Grouse?
Here.
Chair Mueller?
Here.
Liz Hosh?
Here.
Toomey?
Here.
Lise May?
She is at a city council meeting.
Okay. And President O'Donnell?
Here. Thank you. Let's stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Does any board member have any amendments to the agenda? Seeing none, by unanimous consent, the agenda is considered approved, and we'll move on to our presentation by UHS school leader Brian Alford. Good evening and welcome.
Thank you. Good evening, Superintendent Pruitt, board members, central administration, community members. My name is Brian Alford, and it's my first introduction to many of you. I am the student leader of family and student affairs at University High School. And as soon as we get the projector up and going, I'll go through the presentation.
Mr. Good, if you could dim the lights a little bit, please. Thank you.
So, I didn't do all this great work by myself. This is definitely a collaborative effort. Ms. Jeffries and Mr. Beatty, the other two principals there, we'd like to welcome you to some of our initiatives and focus for this year. We like to call it our year of awesomeness. So three of our focus initiatives, the first is a PD focus for staff this year for culture and student engagement and questioning and discussion for us to all grow in our practice around high level engagement activities and workshop model instruction. For example, we have our teachers reading three books. One is on helping students grow in questioning skills, teaching students of poverty, and also standards-based grading. Next, we have growing our new and returning partnerships with universities. And then lastly, our ILTs, instructional lead teacher team initiatives and college prep activities. So this year we have some new additions. We like to start off the school year with what we call first 4 days, which is an opportunity because we have so many students coming from different area schools coming together at one at UHS is we do 4 days of activities to help them get acclimated to the UHS climate, as well as get acclimated to each other. And some of the changes we had this year were for the juniors and seniors who had already been through that process, we had a leadership conference. So we took them through some different activities, some workshops to kind of help them see how their role as upperclassmen plays a part in the culture, as well as helping the younger 9th and 10th graders to know how to follow the UHS way, is what we like to call it in our building. The College Focus Day, we had panelists from former UHS graduates come in and talk to the students. They always like the scavenger hunt, which is a lot of fun. And then the College Facts presentation is what I really enjoyed with the Wayne State College Fair. So we had different colleges coming to our gymnasium from Wayne State. And a lot of the younger students usually don't a lot of times get to interact with the colleges until they get into upper class grades. So with having, you know, about three or four different colleges from Wayne State there, the 9th and 10th graders had an opportunity to go around the gym and just see how it was to be at a college fair and get some pretty good information to get started in their high school career. Next we had on the 17th, Stand Up to Bullying, which we kind of changed it up. We had anti-bullying, which is kind of teaching kids don't be a bully, but we want the student body to grow and not just having people be bystanders, but to learn how to step in and advocate for others, stick together and stand up for each other. So we had stations by grade level, and then they created banners to put up in the school. The other great opportunity they had a public service announcement workshop where we allowed them to use their technology, and they had to go into the hallways in groups and create a public service announcement for standing up to bullying. So those were some pretty cool videos to take a look at. Then we have our Subway partnership is with, our PBIS partnership is with Subway. So we use those within the building to give the kids positive rewards for when we see them doing pretty good things in the school, and we just like to feed them as well. They love to go and eat. Just a few pictures of some of the activities that we did on the first 4 days. The two students on the right are two of our senior students who are involved in DECA, and we're working together right now on a project where they want to just kind of bring awareness to students to be able to take ownership of, you know, we all have different strengths, different challenges, and so we're kind of working collaboratively to work together as a whole school to do that project. So they've been putting in some good work. Fall semester, as many of you know, our seniors go down to Wayne State for half of the day. This year will be for half of the year, and we like to consider this part of their immersion experience, which is part of the foundation of University High School, and what we like to tell people is going to help benefit them in the long run. So they've been going down and having these different activities. They had the welcome panel where you have different colleges come and talk, different people from different areas of the college come and talk to the students, as well as visiting different colleges at the university. So they go into the psychology department, engineering department, and a lot of the professors that are part of the Wayne State Advisory Board have been very supportive. They've been very outgoing in helping to support our students getting into those different colleges down there to see what that's all about. They go into the library, do a scavenger hunt, and get acclimated to the different services in the library. The C2 pipeline, some of the money that they were granted through their grants, and the C2 pipeline is an after-school program where we partner with Wayne State and help the students in science and math. We were able to take some of our senior students and go down, and they built a state-of-the-art lab on the Wayne State campus for this program. And so our science teacher spoke today, and that was one of her celebration speaking points, is that she was so excited that our students were able to operate within a state-of-the-art lab and really have a great experience down at Wayne State. Another part of our focus with our partnerships is the 3D printing, which was a donation where we're working with the C2 pipeline as well. And our students have been working with some of our teachers with this program. And I think the last thing that they created with the 3D printer were whistles. So you just hear kids going around blowing whistles, but it's pretty cool when, if you've ever seen it, to see how you can create things with a 3D printer. It's pretty awesome. Another part of extending our partnerships, we've really been working on this, is that the student teaching lab school. So right now we have 16 pre-student teachers within our building, and they've paired them with various different teachers. But what's really been beneficial is that it gives us a lot of flexibility to be able to help some of our other students that may need help in various areas in smaller group settings. So in some classrooms, we actually have two student teachers along with, you know, the primary teacher. So it's really been quite helpful. Sometimes you go into the room and you see two or three kids in there really engaged in learning, and then as well as student teacher really having a great experience to be able to you know, work with students on a smaller scale. Another part is our Baker College Early College Program. Currently, we have 32 juniors from our school enrolled in this program across the four different majors. They go at various times to the actual Baker College campus and do various activities. Right now, they go to and do their online classes 4 days a week, and on one day out of the week, they come over to Ferndale High School, where they actually meet with their professor and do work in their program with their professor. Currently at this time, they've had some experiences. I know one day I saw the kids in the lunchroom with the garden fresh with the nachos and the salsa, and I'm like, man, where all of this stuff come from? So they started to tell us about their experience in going to Garden Fresh and how enlightening it was, and they seemed like they really enjoyed themselves. And you know, having that connected to their education seemed like it was really a good experience for them. So this is all connected to the blending learning model. And as I expressed, they had online courses several days a week, and they come over here for their instruction with their professors. Just some more pictures of the students operating in the lab down at Wayne State. I believe on the right and also on the left. It's just been good. I think they just recently had a panel down at Wayne State as well. And I know when I was going down as the college transition advisor, the students really, really absorb when you have people that are more closely related to their age, and they talk to them about that experience of going to college, the different pitfalls and what have you, but they really have their ears open to hear from them, so that's a good immersion experience. ILT-led school initiatives and extended learning opportunities. These are some things from last year. Got Science Program, Little Bits Engineering Activity, Authors Inc., which is an after-school writing club. The students have really started to get into that. They actually published a book last year, and we have that in the office, and it's really been a great work to just see them grow in that area. The SAT camp on Saturdays, we just had one this past Saturday. We had a pretty decent turnout, so Ms. Jeffries was actually over that. It's a pretty good deal. And then what we have new for this coming year, the SAT Word of the Week app for juniors. So again, using technology, our ILTs have created the little scan codes, and they have them posted all over the building so the students can go through, and when they see one, use their phone, scan it, and then it'll pull up the word of the week, and just something, you know, to kind of keep the kids engaged and let them know that the SAT is coming, and you do want to continue to keep working anytime that you have an opportunity to grow. Monthly Tech Club, again, working with the 3D printer, upcoming APSA Endurance Workshop. This is a focus that we have to really try to help the students get more stamina. You know, when you're taking any type of standardized test, especially when you're doing an essay, you get tired, you get fatigued. So just like lifting weights, you want them to get more stamina mentally. So they created this opportunity for them to write multiple essays and build their endurance before they get to the actual test. Standards-based grading, monthly meetings. The lunch bunch readings, we actually have one today where the teachers send out articles, and they come in, you know, at their leisure and just kind of read and learn a little bit more about standards-based grading. And then I Spy, teachers just have an opportunity to collaborate, to continue to build that collaborative culture that we have at UHS, and, you know, teachers can go into each other's classrooms and just pick up little, you know, techniques and strategies to be able to improve their practice. Our Picture Perfect group had a wonderful opportunity. They went up to Lansing and they were awarded for their public service announcements. They got a chance to meet some state representatives and a senator. Then next we have our DECA, Operation Good Cheer. This is one of our largest student organizations, and they go and they adopt several children and families, and when they do their fundraising activities, they actually donate those goods to the family. And lastly, we have our partnership that we just started recently with former Principal Mr. Ivory and Mr. Harris with the Southeast Oakland Coalition Student Leadership Advocacy Group. So we had a recent meeting, and we're just looking forward to the positive student leadership activities that we're going to partake in and just continue to build our students up in that area. Anybody have any questions for me?
Thank you for all your work, Mr. Alford.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Alford.
Thank you.
Next up, we have our student representative section of the meeting, and I see Sunesia Smith is here from UHS. So come on, hobble on up to the podium.
All right, how's everybody doing?
Good, how are you?
I'm good, crippled, but good. Speaking of crippled, just get right into it. Basketball season started. And basketball season started, so I kind of got my injury. I got it Thursday. We were going against Berkeley, and that was a little tough game, but I'll be okay, just in case anybody was wondering. Our JV boys are starting off to a good season. They played Country Day, and it was a tie, but they didn't go into overtime. So I guess it was a win-win kind of situation, I guess. So varsity boys are doing well, too. Actually, this week, we actually play together, like boys, varsity boys, JV boys, and varsity girls. We play Pontiac tomorrow, and then Wednesday is officially our first home game. Our first home game was actually supposed to be last week against UPrep, but it was scheduling difficulties, so we didn't play them. We play Madison Heights, and then Saturday, everybody's looking forward to our game against Ferndale. That's an exciting game, so I'm looking forward to that. Mr. Alford pretty much touched on everything I was going to talk about. So the Wayne State University events, senior capstone day with panel discussion from Wayne State students in different majors. So different students talked about their majors and asked questions and stuff like that. Mrs. Thomas's biochemistry students worked in the lab. You saw those pictures. And Mr. Rabel's senior composition classes worked in the Wayne State University library with the Wayne State University staff on their senior research papers, trying to get like an actual feel for what it would actually be like in college for your research papers. Because I've gotten like a lot of emails kind of like from the students that graduated last year, the seniors graduated last year. Oh my God, I have a paper. I have like two papers this week. So it's crazy. So that's really exciting. DECA Districts is this Wednesday. They leave Wednesday. So Ms. Watkins is looking forward to a great little competition for there. That's pretty much it. Art club, we have that almost every day. It's a few students that go. I try to participate when I can, kind of everywhere right now. But besides that, that's pretty much it. Any questions, concerns, comments?
When do you get to lose that brace?
Hopefully in a couple of days, because it was a lot worse, Thursday. I was in crutches. It was just so painful, very painful. So hopefully in a couple of days.
All right,
thank you for asking.
I have a question. Mm-hmm. Have you gotten a chance to use a 3D printer?
No, I haven't, but it sounds very exciting. So it sounds really cool. So hopefully I'll get a chance to do that too.
Okay.
Just work my way around. So.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much.
You're
thank
very
you.
Welcome.
Have a great break if we don't see you.
Oh, thank you.
Appreciate it. And is Crystal here from FHS?
No, she was not available this evening.
All right, then we'll ask Mr. Shelton to come up and present our Eagles of the Month.
Thank you very much. As you know, we've started this program this year to, on a monthly basis, acknowledge both teachers and support staff who go above and beyond to really make a difference for our district. And this is our Eagle of the Month program. And I have tonight a support staff person, an elementary teacher, and a secondary teacher that I'm proud to give some public recognition to for all the good they do for our district and our kids. The first person I'd like to acknowledge is Mr. David Straka from the Career Center. And if you'd like to come on, Mr. Straka. David was nominated by his supervisor, Pam Belliver, who's in the audience tonight, as is Mr. Straka's mother, from what I understand.
My mom right here, Patricia.
All right. Hey, Mom.
And I'd like to share a little bit of what Ms. Belliver shared with me about David and his work at the Career Center. David is a career advisor. He is constantly working with other offices to upgrade the Career Center's forms and processes to incorporate new policies and remain compliant. David takes on additional responsibilities without concern or complaint and is always willing to help other coworkers with anything that they may need assistance with. He is always researching new ways to help customers and epitomizes teamwork. Ms. Belliver nominated David actually for the last 2 months, and thank you for your persistence in helping us get some right recognition for David. So, congratulations. Our Elementary School Eagle of the Month is to my left, Miss Deb Hillebrand. Will you please stand? No, you're on my right. Deb teaches music at both Kennedy and at Roosevelt. She was nominated by Diana Keefe, who is in the audience tonight, to help us acknowledge Deb. Here's what Miss Keefe shared with me about Deb. Deb is reflective and thoughtful about the music lessons that she engages the students with. She takes into account their needs and interests. She is an important part of the JFK and Roosevelt school families, giving 100% at both schools. Deb goes above and beyond by supporting other music programs in Ferndale and offering her support at evening concerts. Her support also extends to PTA, which in turn benefits all students. We're very proud to have you as part of our Ferndale family. For our Secondary Teacher Eagle of the Month, this worked out really well because this is also a teacher who's here for a different reason tonight as well, and that is Rick Purnak. Could you please come on? Rick was nominated by Sean Butler. Rick is a teacher at Ferndale Middle School as well as the cross-country coach at the high school. Rick has built the Ferndale High School cross-country program into a perennial league powerhouse over the last 4 years. This year, the Eagles won the Boys OAA League Championship, 2 invitational meets, and 2 league jamboree meets. What is more impressive is the mentoring Rick has done with his athletes as individuals. He teaches them the true meaning of hard work and commitment. He is dedicated well beyond the athletic field, mentoring students when they have problems, teaching them the importance of being a good student, and doing all this in a sport that does not have the recognition of big crowds or playing in front of their peers. Rick puts in insane hours for his student athletes as he works with them and for them year-round. He is one of the most respected coaches in the state and one of the best coaches I've ever had in my tenure as athletic director. He exemplifies what a positive teacher and coach can bring out in our students. So, congratulations. And I will be back next month with more good news, more good recognition to share. Thank
right.
you.
Thanks, Mr. Shelton. And next up is our athletic award presentation. And Mr. Good will be standing in for Mr. Butler.
Yes, Tom Shelton just mentioned with Mr. Purnak's accomplishments, of course, behind every great coach is even better players. So what's really great tonight is we get a chance to honor some of the OAA champion cross-country team members that are here with us today, as well as we had a state qualifying swimmer as well. So it's always great to see our individual athletes excel as well as our teams. So first, if I could have McKenna Bellamy come up. McKenna qualified. McKenna qualified for the state meet in swimming in 2 events. Which events?
The 200 IM and the 100 fly.
And how'd you do?
I could have done better.
True athlete.
Congratulations.
Congratulations. Right, great job. Thank you very much.
Next, we have another state qualifier for our cross-country team, Mr. Will McElgin. Did I get that right?
Yeah.
Yeah, all right. Will was one of the spearheads of the cross-country team, and you qualified for states as well. How'd you do?
I could have done better.
Darn states.
Don't shake Mr.
I'm sure your mom has hand sanitizer.
And finally with us tonight is Mr. Jacob Keener. If you could come up too, please. Jacob was another one of our fantastic members of the league champion cross country team. Congratulations.
Congratulations. Thank you very much. And obviously a member of our robotics team also.
That's right. So it was a fantastic fall for our sports. We're looking forward to an even better winter. So we'll see you guys in a couple months with some more athletic awards.
All right. Thanks to the moms and dads, too.
And for the parents and the students, I know you probably have a lot of different homework, so you don't need to stay around unless you really want to. But feel free to head home. And.
Well, you know how to clear out a room.
Yes, I do.
All right, we're going to move next to our public comment. So as you know, this is the time for public participation in our meeting. We want to make sure that all members of the public have an opportunity to participate in the work of the school district in many ways, through emails, phone calls, meetings, town halls. And we want individual and group input into the important issues that face our schools. So at this time, I will invite anyone who wants to comment to come up and form a line at the podium. Each speaker gets 3 minutes. Doesn't look like we'll need more than 30 minutes tonight, but just ask that you follow guidelines. If you need a response, please state your name and address. So the administrators can follow up with you if you need any additional assistance. And everybody gets this opportunity to address the board both on agenda or non-agenda items. And finally, we just ask that any complaints about staff be made outside of this meeting and following the standard board policy on public complaints, because we can't respond to any complaints in the meeting, and that makes it more fair for both the complainant and the person that the complaint is directed to. So, anyone wish to address the board this evening?
Nobody.
All right.
Oh, wait.
Oh. Ms. Amy?
I'll do it.
All right. Welcome.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Nicole Amy. What do you need? Address? You said? No, you don't need my name. Just wanted to say something, I hope briefly. As some of you may know, I typically have no qualms letting you know if there is a problem. So it occurred to me sometime today that maybe sometimes I don't let you know when you're doing something good. So don't be worried. This is good.
I already like this.
So my purpose here right now is, I guess, just to let you know that I was pleasantly, not surprised, but I was very pleased to find out late last week that the kindergarten classes are getting some support that is very much needed. And what was even better about it was that myself or other parents didn't really have to advocate for it, and that the administration did what I thought they should have done. And not that the parents didn't raise some concerns or plant a few bugs in some ears, but in any event, I do appreciate the hard work on that. It does mean a lot to myself and other parents, so thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
That's good feedback. And yeah, I think parents planting a few bugs is always welcome, I think. And
yes,
Mr. Brewer, you also consulted with the kindergarten teachers, mm-hmm. On exactly what form that support would take. So we
yes.
appreciate that too.
Mr. Shelton's been keeping in contact with Ms. Keefe and the teachers, and it's actually a direct correlation to the budget amendment that we'll be talking about later. But due to being better off financially than the first forecast, we're able to take more money and put it back into the classroom, which is where I know as a board and administration where we want to be putting our funds. So we thank the parents and Ms. Keefe and Mr. Shelton and the whole team for doing this.
All right, thank you. Anyone else wish to address the board this evening? All right. Well, we will close public comment and move to our consent agenda. The consent agenda is where we put routine matters that don't need any further discussion or question, have any questions asked about them. So on our consent agenda tonight, we have item 7.1, the request to approve minutes of the regular meeting of November 16th. 2015. 7.2 is a request to approve bills and accounts. 7.3 is a request to approve resignations and new hires. And item 7.4 is a request to approve a letter of intent for an insurance proposal. All of these items are in the board packet. Does any board member wish to remove any of the items from the consent agenda? Seeing none, I'll entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda as presented. Moved by Mr. Deegan Krause and seconded by Ms. Butters. May we have a roll call, please?
Butters?
Yes.
Deegan Krause?
Yes.
Kermuller?
Yes.
Lukash?
Yes.
Toomey?
Yes.
President O'Donnell?
Yes.
Thank you.
That motion passes with 6 yes and 0 no. So the consent agenda items are approved collectively. Item 8.1 is a request to approve the second reading of bylaw 0142.5, which is the process for filling a board vacancy. Do you want to present this? Or? Okay.
I'm trying to pull it up here for a second. At board, and this is our second reading, last month we presented this bylaw, updating our bylaw, since there were some concerns from the Board Governance Committee regarding not having a robust process of if the board gets to a stalemate with multiple votes of 3-3, what would be that process. So this is what the governance committee has recommended. We had the first read last month, and it's looking to see if there's any questions after having the last month to review this.
Can you give me a page number?
It's 44 and 45 of the packet. Well, it's 48 if you're going through the public one, I think. The public one has more pages?
I don't know.
It's
48 for me.
It's the way it downloads from the system.
Maybe it's just spaced out differently. But yeah, I was like trying to find it because, I don't know, Chris's computer doesn't have it, so I can probably does.
So the governance committee made any changes from last month?
No, moved it forward as is.
All right. We can have more discussion when there's a motion, so I'll entertain a motion to approve the bylaw change made by Ms. Latosh, seconded by Mr. Deegan Krause. Discussion on the motion? All right. Seeing none, we will move to a roll call, please.
Deegan Krause?
Yes.
Kermuller?
Yes.
Latosh?
Yes.
Toomey?
Yes.
Yes.
And
yes. So it's 6 yes votes and 0 no. That motion passes and the bylaw change is approved and will go into effect as of today, which we will use on January 4th. Item 8.2 is a request to approve the second read of our NEOLA policies, which were voluminous.
second read for the packet of NEOLA. You'll recall that NEOLA twice a year gives us these big packets of updates that they recommend for us based on legal and legislative changes. This particular packet from NEOLA, I went through it in detail at the last meeting. Most of the changes in there have to do with changes in federal procurement requirements. There are some in there from new USDA regulations, there are some in terms of our district-wide weapons policies, which are really not a change in policy for us, just reaffirming, again, that our schools are all weapon-free zones. I can answer any specific questions anybody has. That's kind of the highlights of what's in this NEOLA update.
Any questions on the 140 pages of policies?
You know, it looked pretty standard.
Yeah, I think they're just standard things bring us into compliance. I'm just curious how often the proposed changes end up coming up in your interactions with the various union leaders and such, because obviously they go to their own unions to hear what the legal changes are in the law.
Sure.
Do these end up coming up in those conversations?
Not a whole lot.
Well?
Not a whole lot. When they're specifically related to personnel and personnel issues, layoff, recall, for example, obviously there's a lot of discussion around those. But other than that, no, we don't have a lot of discussion with our union leaders about policy.
Yeah. We, as the board knows, we do for union leaders before every board meeting to go through items, so they have the opportunity to look through and see if there's any discussion. I forget if it was Trustee Kermuller, if it was you that said these are pretty boilerplate, these are pretty standard. Generally, if there's something that's of major concern, it's coming up as an individual item. But with the amount of legislation that's out there in Lansing, we know that it's constantly changing our policies. So, if anything, I wish we didn't have to spend money on a policy company to update policies.
Well, and I think that's what I was trying to highlight is, since we're having a kumbaya session tonight of what's going right, I mean, that's another piece of the relationship is that we do sit down with our union leaders ahead of meetings and say, hey, this is what's on the agenda.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. So relationships are very important.
So, and any member of the public can page through and see where the choices that we've made, where we have choices, but for the most part, most of these pages are out of our control.
Right.
But here and there, we make some additions, like to the conflict of interest policy, applying it to committees.
And especially with this update, if you look, a lot of them were 10, 12-page policies where there were like two or three minor changes bolded out. So even the changes that we did have this time were relatively minor.
All right. I'll entertain a motion to approve these policies as presented, moved by Ms. Kermuller. Seconded by Mr. Deacon Krause. Any discussion on the motion? All right, roll call, please.
Kermuller?
Yes.
Natasha?
Yes.
Toomey?
Yes.
Letters?
Yes.
Deacon Krause?
Yes.
President O'Donnell?
Yes. With 6 yes and 0 no, the motion passes and the policies are approved.
Thank you.
Yes.
I just noticed that we're still, okay.
Yep.
I was just
going to
say. I was just making sure that you guys saw that she walked in.
I don't know if we want to.
All right, yeah. So without objection, we will go back to item 3.2, and Ms. Revis will address the board about what's happening at Ferndale High School.
Yeah, no problem. I'm sorry. I was having car trouble.
Oh, no.
I apologize.
That's okay.
Do you need any help with the car?
No.
There's a lot of us here.
It's good now. Thank you. I was having some engine troubles. I had to get a jump start. And
Sorry.
We've all been there.
I made it. We're here. First thing I want to talk about was the band concerts and the choir and orchestra concerts. We had amazing attendance. The band concert was on December 3rd. We had the symphony band and the wind ensemble. They did amazing. I was there personally. My brother's in it. He's a freshman this year.
All right.
The choir and orchestra concert was on December 12th. We have about 35% of the school body, the student body, is in either choir, orchestra, or band. So we're very proud of that. We just casted roles recently for the spring musical, which is the Putnam County Spelling Bee. I don't know if any of you guys have heard of it. It's kind of new. The dates have been consolidated onto one weekend. The matinee is March 17th, and it opens March 18th, 19th, and 20th. The 18th and the 19th are both 7:30 shows, and the 20th is a 3 p.m. show. This past Saturday, we held our second SAT camp. We had about 70 students took the work keys part of the test. Yeah. So, and we'll get the scores back to them by the end of break or when we come back from break. They also did two reading samples as two reading samples from the test that they are going to be taking. This past Sunday, we held the Senior Citizen Luncheon. That's hosted by USA. I'm a part of USA. And it's one of our most cherished events. It's our baby. Unfortunately, this is my last year in USA since I'm graduating, and it was really hard to let it go. I was very excited. They were all wishing me goodbye, and I almost teared up. wrestling to sports news. Wrestling just won the Marine Corps Toys for Tots tournament. Yeah, it's pretty good. We also had an individual winner, Kobe Davis, who won gold medal in his class weight challenge. And Saturday the 19th, December 19th, we have a basketball game against UHS, so it's kind of like a inter-district rivalry. We have 11:30 game, it's the JV boys. 1 o'clock game is girls varsity, so it's both girls and boys against each other. Not against each other, but it's both of the teams. And then we have our boys varsity team at 3 p.m. So I hope to see you guys there.
All right.
And that's all from my end. Sorry. Okay.
Thank you very much,
great.
Crystal.
No, thanks a lot.
Let us know if you have trouble with the car.
Yes.
If it doesn't start again, I'm sure we have someone that has jumper cable.
Thank you.
Yes. I know I do. Item 8.3 is a request to approve the first budget amendment of fiscal year 2016. Ms. Hoover will present that. Good evening.
Good evening. So this is our first budget amendment for the 15-16 year. As you can see, we've made some substantial increases, both to revenue and expenditures, which is a good thing. The major change in revenue, we're very conservative in in the number of students that we projected, and the enrollment. Bill's area did a really great job working to make sure we got as many students in as we could, and because of that, we had a very large increase over our projected enrollment of about 277 students. Again, this is an unaudited number. And I was talking to Cindy earlier, and she said, yes, they're already starting to deduct for the students. They deduct students that move by month up until the second count, so they've already started to take those few students away from us. But otherwise, it's a really great change.
They also give us students that we take
yes,
in from other
yes,
places.
Yes, we get both.
So.
It's a swap back and forth, but yeah. The state has already started it. Unfortunately, they changed that, and they do that by month now instead of just at the count dates. So this increase in revenue is offset by a reduction in the MIPSERS UAL, which, again, is a pass-through, both the revenue side and the expenditure side, because we were a little high in our projection of what that was going to be. So there we're showing, so in state revenue, it's about a $2.2 million increase in revenue for a total increase in revenue of about $2.4 million from the original budget. On the expenditure side, we have increased total instruction by $1.2 million. The majority of that is due to the increase of additional teachers that we've needed because of the additional students. So we added six elementary teachers. We added a 0.8 teacher at the middle school. We have four teachers with additional class loads, which is where they decide to teach on their prep route. as well as we've had teacher overages that we will be paying for the increase in class size. And that's the majority of the increases in instruction. It takes us from about 52%, 52.5% of our expenditures in total in basic instruction to 53.76. So we are heading in the right direction and showing that the majority of our increase in expenditures is going directly into the classroom. At the same time, if you look at total support services, that has gone down from just under 1%. So even though we did increase there, the total percentage of those expenditures have gone down by about 1%. So we really are trying to focus and increase the instructional expenditures and put more money in the classroom and keep it out of the support area. In the instructional staff area, that increased about 24%. And that was from some additional staff that we needed at TCEC because of the increase in enrollment. So we've added an additional data analyst there, as well as added supervision there. We've also established a textbook budget, which in our original budget, we did remove that when we were trying to balance our budget at the beginning. And so we've added that back in. And also TCEC, with their with adult ed and their Section 107 fundings, they were able to purchase some computer carts with the additional allocation they got. So those are some of the increases that were in that area. So this takes us, our original budget, we were projecting an ending fund balance of $442,000, which is about 1.42% of revenue. And I've changed this to make it fund balance as a percentage of revenue, because this is what the state looks at as a percentage of revenue, not as a percentage of expenditures, when they're looking at whether or not we're hitting the 5%.
Oh, okay.
So I've changed that. And with the additional revenue minus the additional expenditures, plus the change, the increase in the projection from the audit, we are now looking at, in addition to fund balance, and we're looking at ending fund balance of $1,825,813, which gets us to about 5.44% fund balance.
Yeah, great work, everyone, starting with Bill. But
and ahead of schedule.
Yes, so we have, you know, we've gone from a situation that was was critical, really, where we're in some significant trouble. And is there still a sense that there's declining enrollment in the county?
Yes, overall. Obviously, the fully audited counts haven't come out, but in general conversations with other superintendents, generally most districts have seen a continued decline as they have. With the exception being South Lyon, and they've been seeing increases for years just because of new subdivisions, but it's been a general decline within the county. I think when it comes out, we'll see an overall enrollment decrease countywide.
Well, I know we in the sustainability committee, and which is what we used to call the finance committee, we talked quite a bit about, spent some time talking about the instructional additions, the extra teachers we were adding on, and then looking at the financial report, which is also in the packet. The budget amendment, but the financial report in the which fed into this is in a similar format, and you know things are going along according to plan, and everything seems to be well managed, and we'll continue to keep an eye on things. And
our goal is to continue to increase instructional spending, do our best to decrease non-instructional spending, and keep our fund equity above 5%.
So I'll entertain a motion to approve the budget amendment number one as presented. Moved by Ms. Toomey. Seconded by Ms. Latosh. Any discussion on the motion? is item 8.4, request to approve the Ferndale Middle School coding class pilot. And Ms. Rochelot will present that. Or introduce that, I should say, not present.
Good evening. Tonight we're going to share with you some good news about some of the coding activities that are taking place at our actually all of our campuses, starting at Ferndale Middle School. And Lauren will share with you what some of our other schools did with the Hour of Code last week. But everyone is really into this computer science, and it's becoming more and more popular with our students. So based on an after-school club that Lauren started at Ferndale Middle School, we are not now asking to start a pilot coding elective. One of our goals is to have some more academic type of electives for our students with this. And as soon as our high school teachers heard that we were piloting this at the middle school, they are already asking if it's going to happen at the high school shortly. So with that, I will introduce Lauren, who will go through this short PowerPoint and share some of our success stories to date.
Good evening. I'm Lauren Villaluz. I'm the Technology Integration Specialist. I'm working through Oakland Schools. And I'm really excited to talk to you a little bit about what we've been doing with the Google CS First program. Google CS First, if you don't already know, stands for Google Computer Science First. And I have been piloting the program in the form of a club, an after-school club at Ferndale Middle School for the past month or so. We'll wrap it up this week, and it has been going phenomenally. We also, last week was Computer Science Education Week, and we had a teacher at every single building in the district participate in Hour of Code, which is basically bringing in, connecting to the curriculum, existing curriculum, and introducing students to coding and getting them excited about it and showing them that anyone can learn code and that they can pick up basic coding skills within the context of an hour. And so that was fantastic. We did that with kindergarten class all the way up to high school level, and it was very well received. And so I wanted to tell you a little bit about the Computer Science First program, as that is what we are looking at the basis for our curriculum for the elective course at Ferndale Middle School. The CS First program is a free resource. It's a free computer science club put out by Google. It utilizes Massachusetts Institute of Technology's Scratch programming, web-based program. It's an introduction to coding. It uses blocks as its coding language, which is basically the foundation for JavaScript, which is pretty exciting, very, very approachable for all students of all ages. And this program is designed for students who are familiar with coding or students who are brand new to coding. Its entry level is, you know, it's got challenges. It's also got very basic instruction, and it's very student-led as far as the program goes. So I just wanted to walk you through a little bit about what we've been doing. Why computer science? Number one, it has piqued the students' interests. They've basically been stuck with consuming many materials, and you know, we see them consuming materials on computers all the time, but we want to encourage them and empower them to be able to actually create those materials, and that is what computer science can give to them, and what learning just a foundational skills in coding can enable them to do animation, can enable them to build their own games, to exercise things that they're already using in their curricular content areas, and make them actually come to life. So an example of their creating versus consuming. So they're actually building programs, animations, different things based off of different themes. Another reason that we're really interested in bringing this program to our students is because we know that it's growing, and we know that it's not going anywhere. This is a nationwide statistic from code.org, and this is something that we shared during Hour of Code as well, that no matter what career you're interested in, you can find some sort of connection to coding and to computer science, and that the jobs are growing at 2 times the national average. Another reason that I'm passionate about bringing this program to our students is because 75% of our population is underrepresented in computer science. So explaining to students that we want to get them interested, particularly at the middle school level, bringing in that early exposure so that we are able to change that statistic that we see up there with females, you know, and students of color not being represented in computer science. Even Google admits itself with their demographics that they have the same problem. In our Google CS First Pilot Club, we have the same problem. So I'm hoping that in bringing it actually in as an elective course, we will bring in more, you know, make it more accessible to all students rather than make it, you know, this stick to the stereotype that exists currently. And there has been research to prove that early exposure to a subject can generate interest and curiosity while building their competency. And I can see that firsthand within the program. So, you know, while they're building that identity, making them comfortable with coding and showing them that they do have the capacity to do this, I think will enable them in the future to consider, you know, using these skills. The CS First key objectives are courage to try new things, confidence when using computers in general, because it's building even just general computer skills, scrolling and, you know, watching a video and comprehending. Perseverance is huge to tackle difficult problems. This is project-based learning. If they don't build their code correctly, it's not going to work. So then they have to go back and they have to try again. So they definitely are working on their perseverance and collaboration as well. And we're hoping that it will have an impact on both our community and their future careers. We also hope to build a sense of belonging in tech for underrepresented students, so giving them a place where this is accessible to them. Just a little bit about the program. We have been running it as a club, but it's very flexible. There are themed sessions, so those are the themes up there. We started with storytelling, which I can say is interesting, whether you're, you know, no matter in what grade level you're approaching it, it's been designed so that it's just a very high interest theme. And each of these has about 10 hours of content across the different sessions. So we would take all of those themes and incorporate them into the curriculum of the elective course because they would all fit perfectly. And the class structure just kind of looks like an opening discussion. And the great thing about this is even myself not necessarily having the deepest background in coding, this is meant to be facilitated by people who might not be super comfortable with coding. Because you're building skills right alongside the students. You're learning right alongside them. So with some foundational knowledge, you're able to facilitate their coding knowledge without necessarily having to be able to write extensive code yourself, which is great to be able to have that opportunity without necessarily needing all the skills. We then usually move into showcasing projects. So we'll take students' projects, put them up on the board, talk about them, you know, highlight things that were easy about it, difficult. Oh, you know, how did you do that? How did you make him spin? That kind of a thing. And then they use the CS First curriculum, which is basically they have videos and challenges that they have to complete. So they'll watch a video and then have to try something. Then they'll watch another video, have to try something else. And at the end, they'll have built some sort of project. So every session involves some sort of task that they have to accomplish. And then at the end, they'll usually close and then share out with each other what they've done. And here's some of the impact from our specific students. Those are actually our Google CS First Club. Down at the bottom, that is their, at the end of each session, they have a quick little survey that they take. And so I look forward to doing Computer Science Club. Strongly agree or agree. I've been successful so far in this club. Strongly agree and agree. I would recommend this club to a friend. So all very positive feedback from these students. Again, they're voluntary participants, but you know, they also could volunteer to not show up the next day, and they do, so it is good. They also, I think, said something about the rigor of this program. Do you think computer science is difficult? After completing some of this, they said, most of them admitted, yeah, it can be difficult at times. But the next question is, do you think it's worth the effort? And all pretty much all agree that yes, most of the time it's definitely worth the hard work and the rigor and the, you know, the problem solving that I have to go through to be able to do this coding. So I think that's great feedback straight from our Ferndale Middle School students. what we need to start basically with this Google CS First elective is a lab, a teacher host. Google CS First provides all the rest of the supplies. So they provide an online platform for you to assign usernames and passwords for the students, and then the teacher keeps track of all of that data. They have passports and badges just as a motivational tool as well for them to monitor their own progress through CS First. And then there's also plans and solution sheets that would help the teacher to kind of facilitate the class. I did want to show you just a really quick example, and I don't know if I can do it here. This is an actual story that we have just completed as of last week. So this is one of our students, and this is just an example of what Scratch looks like. Again, they're in the storytelling version, so this is a quick story. This is an interactive story. Vocabulary that's introduced to them as well is all programming vocabulary. They're talking about looping, algorithms, all of those are introduced, and that's what they're practicing within there. So even though the platform is a little bit more basic, all of the concepts are applicable to different programming languages.
I don't have a question, I just have a comment. My middle son was actually in your coding class, and he absolutely adored it, and would come home telling me able to do, and the making of characters talk, and he found it to be really exciting and interesting, and it wasn't like a previous interest of his, so I was impressed.
Great, that's really good to hear.
And this to me speaks of the flexibility of the board, as well as the system of having a smaller school district. You know, Ms. Rushlow's department, if you would ask at the beginning of the year, was this one of our necessary goals? Not necessarily, but as Lauren brought it to our attention and Ms. Rushlow's department worked on it, you know, it fit with our goals as a school district. In other larger school districts, this would not be possible to do. So it's really due to the work of the curriculum department and the flexibility of the size of our district to be able to adapt to our students and adapt what's out there in a timely manner.
So I have a question. Related to that, then, are there any other schools that have something similar, or are you familiar?
That have computer science courses? Yes. Google CS First incorporated into the curriculum. I do know of technology courses at the middle school level that are using the curriculum. Mm-hmm. They might not only be using Google CS First, they might also be supplementing with something like Code Academy, which is very similar programming. Just slightly, you know, it kind of depends on the concept that you're looking to teach the students and how long, time constraints, that kind of a thing. You know, what your formatting of your program is, and this particular program just fits what we were looking for.
And could you talk about, since if we're making it a class and it's no longer a club,
mm-hmm.
can you talk about how the assessment will work?
So at the end of that I pulled for you, that you saw the results on there, that is built into there. However, I personally, each lesson has a project of some sort. Every lesson, there is a built-in assessment. And that project can be assessed. So at the end of every, lesson that they've completed, they were supposed to, for example, that one was an interactive story. So there is a specific amount of code that needed to be in that story so that I knew that they knew how to make an interactive
story. There's a rubric that the student will
yes.
be able to
yep. mm-hmm.
follow and then get a grade,
yes.
just like a regular class.
Correct. Yes.
All right, so on page in your packet, the what, how, and why in the curriculum proposal form start on page 619.
The curriculum is not 600 pages, just being clear here.
No, it was about 400 pages.
Yeah.
Lost in the pages.
It was
pretty long.
In depth.
So I'll entertain a motion to approve this computer coding pilot class as an elective at Ferndale Middle School starting in the second semester. Moved by Ms. Kermuller. Is there a second? Seconded by Ms. Latash. Any discussion on the motion?
I guess just another question. So how we've had it. No, this isn't the first pilot program here. Do we have a standard evaluation we have at the end to determine whether we move forward with a pilot program?
There isn't currently, but probably within the Achievement Committee, we can develop that. There is nothing within policy or nothing within the district that's been there in the past. So either within governance or achievement, depending on how we want to deal with that, but that is something that could easily come up with a process or a tool.
I think it would be helpful.
I have another question too. I don't know. Does this class? Can we access any of the Oakland County CT funds? Do those even exist anymore?
Not for middle school.
Oh, not for middle school.
Yep.
Never mind. Yeah. Okay. Just got that.
All right. Any other questions or discussion on the motion? Seeing none, may we have a roll call on the motion to approve the pilot curriculum class and class?
Yes.
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 Yes. With six yes, that motion passes. Zero no, that motion passes. And the pilot class is approved.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Can I just make a note that
yes.
she's done a great job of tweeting all of this out? So if you're not following her on Twitter, you should be.
Oh,
and I'm so happy to finally meet you face to face. I've been following you for several weeks, but the hour of code was a great hashtag to follow, and
mm-hmm.
there were kids doing computer programming throughout the whole district, and it was really. I think it's been great.
I saw a ton of it on Facebook too, like tons of parents being like, "Oh my goodness,
mm-hmm.
my second grader."
What was your handle?
At Senora, Spanish teacher.
L-U-Z.
All right. Well, thank you very much.
L-U-Z. Just because you're not near the mic. No, I.
All right. Well, thank you very much. Next up is our informational section. So item 9.1 is the superintendent report.
So one of the pieces that we discussed some in, in the governance committee that I wanted to bring to the board for discussion was looking at school board term policy. I believe right now, looking at the six-year terms, there was some discussion from the governance members of moving it down to four-year terms as something that's a little more palatable to people as they sign up for 4 years as opposed to six. So as superintendent, I didn't necessarily have any opinion, honestly, either way on it. It just depends on what we need to do for the community to continue to attract good board members. So I just kind of wanted to bring that forward and see if there's any questions from board members regarding that. We're going to have a little bit of discussion regarding that or your thoughts.
So, and Kevin, you had done the legwork of getting a hold of Joe Rozelle at the Oakland County Director of Elections in the clerk's office.
Yeah, I just to put this in all the context, in 2010, the school board voted to change the election date. That was in part because the state had shifted the days when you could have elections. At the same time that they did that, they also decided to lengthen the terms from 4 to 6 years. I think a number of us had some questions about that at the time, especially because it meant at the time lengthening the terms of sitting board members. But also, because six-year terms is a very is a long time to get them to do an initial commitment to, especially people who have young children and uncertain job situations, but who would otherwise make great school board members. And so we've done some investigating on this. There don't seem to be any major downsides to reducing it back to 4 years. The only argument that's come up has been that when you do reduce it to 4 years, and have elections every second year, you're always in a situation where either three or four board members are being elected, so that there is the potential for a dramatic change in school board membership. My gut feeling, having lived through this, is that even with a dramatic change in school board membership, you don't necessarily lose the continuity utterly. I think we had about as big a change in school board membership as we could have had from 2012 to 2013, and the systems were not disrupted. There was no fundamental break, and there was no problem, actually, with four school board members who hadn't previously served on the school board but had served in other places to coming onto a school board and getting up and running very quickly. So I think, you know, given that we've already lived through the most extreme case scenario, and it seems to have gone fairly well, given the budget and other situations, there doesn't seem to be any reason not to do it. So I spoke to Joe Rozelle at Oakland County County Elections, and he said that you cannot, by law, shorten a term, and you need to keep a certain staggering of terms so that there aren't five elected at one point and two elected at another, so it has to be even. Given those restrictions, we can't actually shorten the terms for the 2016 election, but what we could do is make the determination that all subsequent years would be four-year elections, and that would put us eventually on a 4-3 schedule. So the first time this would actually take effect would be 2018, but beginning in 2018, school board members would be elected for a four-year term. So that's the, I think, initial reasoning and logistics of it, it seemed like a worthwhile thing to at least investigate with the rest of the board.
Right. So in 2016, there'll be two seats up. In 2018, two. And then we start 3 and 4 cycles.
And just to piggyback, as having been part of that old board, while I did vote against it, that was the primary concern, was that rapid turnover. However, the research has said that the average school board member in the region tends to serve 12 years. So in reality, you're probably always going to be having one or two established members on that ticket already. The chances of people all choosing to at the same time. What this does do is it offers the reason that we have elections, which is the democratic accountability. So if there is an issue, the public is able to address it.
I'm thrilled about this. I think Karen and I both probably are pretty excited. I think it's...
You can tell in your voice.
Just a little bit too late for us, though.
Well, I mean, it was very sad to have so many people show up at that election where we did vote to increase the terms, and knowing that the bulk of the community did not support it and it still went through was... it was hard to be on the board and have that happen. What I think is really interesting, and I just didn't hear you mention this before, so we can vote to increase terms.
Not beyond six.
Right.
But we can't vote to decrease the term.
Decrease them.
We can't vote to decrease the term of an existing board member, and if we were to vote to decrease the terms for 2016, we would be left in an asymmetrical situation.
No. I totally get what you're saying. I just think it's interesting that back then we could vote to increase, and then time was lumped onto my thing, which was fine, but nobody had to vote on that.
That's right. I mean, I think it's important to mention, at the time when the hearing was held, time we got to get a sense of public opinion, there were 19 statements in favor, one neutral, and one against for the increase in the terms. I was counting.
So what I hear is that it would be advisable for the superintendent to bring this back to governance.
I would love
to
it.
Then
for
to,
first read
for to craft a
yeah.
That's our two biggies.
Yeah, that would
the
be
extension of the
brilliant.
Terms and getting rid of that. What was that superfluous speech clause?
Oh,
moving on.
So. What was I going to say? So, yeah, this will go to governance for a first read. Oh, yeah, and the superintendent also ran this by MASB's legal counsel, which is already included in the price of our membership. So I wouldn't say free, but... and he also approved the language, so this will go to governance at the January meeting.
Right. Today being actually the anniversary of Sandy Hook, I wanted to bring to the board some of the things we're doing of crisis planning. Actually, as of today, speaking with our police liaison, she will be going to an updated training to bring back to the district. We're updating our crisis plans. I've met with every municipality in even the state police in terms of readiness and preparedness with the buildings. I will be doing some more drills once we get into the spring with the work the board's already approved on the wall by the band room that'll make our campus here secure for the first time. We put all the cameras in, obviously, during the summer, put the door buzzers in. So we're continuing our crisis planning. So there's some updating that we need to do within the different buildings. But that's something that we're ongoing. So I think it's always important for us to be ready and also to let the community know that's something that is in the forefront of our mind. We hope nothing major ever happens. It is such a low likelihood, but as we learned in Sandy Hook, their readiness was what saved many children. So we have great relationships with the local police departments, and we'll continue that, and we'll make sure that we do everything we can to keep our students safe. So any particular questions regarding crisis readiness or crisis preparedness?
I just want to thank you for the sort of calm confidence with which you've approached this. I think we've seen in a variety of settings it being either ignored on the one hand or treated as a kind of hot mess on the other, and you've gone through it very procedurally, very directly, without sort of raising anxieties where they don't need to be raised, but at the same time taking care of the problem. And that's really important on both ends.
That's all I have for my report today.
All right, thank you. We didn't have any pulled consent agenda items, so we're on to Eagle Points of Pride. Who wants to start? Kevin.
I just want to say, my point of pride is the one empty chair here. Both proud of Ray Long, having been a great board member, that into the city council she will bring the concerns that we've talked about, and if she's the liaison here, that she'll bring the concerns of the council back to us. So I think we owe her a lot of thanks. We should be here today, but she's in a better place, or at least a different place. That sounded wrong. She's in a great place, and I'm glad she's there, but I also wish she were here.
Just for clarification, Raylan is at a Ferndale City Council meeting tonight.
Yes.
Yes.
Which is not nearly as fun as our meeting. We've already established that.
Right. Not
but
a
whatever.
Better place.
That's okay. Still fine. She'll do
Did
great
she get to
there.
Watch Talking Fortune Cookies? I don't think so.
Right. Amy?
I'd like to go ahead and publicly acknowledge, I'm always talking about the great supportive community we have here in Ferndale of our school community, and I just want to specifically thank our Ferndale Rotary Club for their pancake breakfast, which I didn't attend, but I know that it was something that they do every year, and it's a fundraiser that they do to support scholarships for our students, and the Rotary Club is a great supporter of our district. And another place of business in Ferndale is Dino's, who recently hosted a fundraiser for Blessings in a Backpack, which is a program that our district is getting up and going. And so that's, you know, Dino's is also always on the list of businesses that's there for our district. And I just wanted to give them a public acknowledgement tonight.
Yeah. And Dean Bach via Embrew also hosted the Rotary Breakfast.
Exactly. So. Yes. So it's all
there
comes
he is again.
Full circle.
Yes.
Yes.
So I was just thinking about how lucky we are in this community to have so many wonderful substitute teachers. I know that my third grader's teacher had to be out on a short medical leave, and it was just so wonderful that, you know, it was a retired teacher returning to the classroom that already had a relationship with the kids. And I look around that building and all the buildings and see how often we're blessed to have retired teachers, aspiring teachers, parents, just dedicated professionals that step in and keep our kids feeling comfortable in the classroom so that our teachers can take care of themselves or sometimes, you know, do their professional development. And I just appreciate that.
Red alert.
Point of pride is that I don't know how to turn my phone off. My point of pride is our elementary teachers and our curriculum staff. Today was another one of the days where they were doing professional development, preparing for next year. As we know, there's a lot of prep work, but it really is student-focused, and it's all about our students achieving. So just watching the work that they're doing, the interactions between the staff members and the teachers, and the excitement that they have for going into the next year and really, you know, creating something special moving forward. So just excited whenever, you know, whenever you have a bad day, go watch teachers, go watch kids. It's just great to see that excitement with our teaching staff.
All right. I want to point out, as one of my points of pride, the little courtyard area that's dark right now, but if you ever walk by it when it's a light outside, that used to be sort of a weedy, neglected mess, and now it's a very zen-like garden. So I appreciate the people from the district that worked on that. And then, because I'm not going to stand for election as president, I just wanted to thank the board administration and the community members for all the support over the last 3 years as president. And I will continue to be on the board, but I've requested to sit down at the end next year. So, you know, it's been a very exciting 3 years, and I certainly appreciate Ms. Shepherd and Mr. Pruitt for making the job as president a lot easier and smoother over the course of the last few years. So thank you very much, and I know our next president will do a great job, and I'll do whatever I can to support her and the rest of the board. Thank you to the board members also.
Thank you for all your service, Jim.
I'm just going to piggyback on what you just said, Jim, and thank you for everything that you've done for our kids and our district and our schools and this board. You have led us through some turbulent changes and some turbulent times, and you've done so with great dignity and respect for utmost of the students, and we could not have asked, I don't think, for a better board president and a board leader. So thank you for everything you've done for us in the district.
Thank you.
Yeah, I agree with everything that Jim said. I, however, have another point of pride too.
Absolutely.
My point of pride right now is for we have a lot of change that's been going on, obviously, just talking about all this. And our community, our teachers, all of the transition meetings, like, everyone is absorbing so much change within our district. And at times it's been really hard, but I really feel like everyone has been, like, really pulling it together and been doing it super gracefully and trying really hard to be open-minded about
pride that I forgot to bring up earlier. If you want to. Yes, you have the knowledge base of it.
We have had a great opportunity for Ferndale Schools, for Ferndale High School, and we have been working with CNBC, the show The Prophet, with Marcus Lemonis, and he goes in, he's an entrepreneur, and he helps people establish businesses and run them with success. He goes into businesses that are not running with success and changes them to be successful. And we've been working with CNBC and Universal Studios out of Florida. And we have had an assembly at Ferndale High School. And we have a challenge to our students to establish a team of 3 to 5 students and develop a business plan and become entrepreneurs. And they have a rubric that they must follow. And then on January 21st, we will be meeting in here with some local businesses, and they will present a 5 to 8 minute presentation on their business plan and all the specifics for it. We'll take the challenges. We will decide on the top challenges, and then we will send them to CNBC and Universal Studios. Marcus Lemonis and CNBC and Universal will then come to our school for an assembly on January 26th. We'll have an all-school assembly in the morning with live cameras running, and he will announce the winners of the challenge, and there are quite a few surprises that go along with that. And then the afternoon, he will be spending time in the classrooms talking about his motivation and what he's done growing up. As well will the executives from CNBC and Universal. They'll be meeting with different groups to talk about their career choices and what other kids can do and all the career opportunities that are in CNBC, Universal, and so forth. And then there's a great surprise that will happen on January 26th for our students.
Great opportunity for our students moving forward.
When is the deadline for the student groups to get their proposal?
Students are to sign up this past week and this week.
Okay.
And then the students and the parents should have received an email with the rubric and a little video from Marcus Lemonis talking about Ferndale High School. And CNBC has really gotten behind this, and now they're thinking that we'll be the first of a national group that they'll try to do some more with this. So we'll see our students on some.
All right. So we'll be bringing more information as it's available.
I'm taking the 26th off of work. All right. So that brings us to our next regular board meeting, which will be on Wednesday, January 20th. Moved the day because of the celebration of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday. And we have it on January 4th. Just a note, we have our special meeting preceding the organizational meeting to select a new board member, and the organization meeting at which we assign committees, elect officers, and that sort of thing. So with those notes, we are adjourned at 8:32.